Hi, my name is Heather Francisco, and I'm a Board Certified Behavior Analyst with Brett DiNovi and Associates. What actually passes as a behavior that can be objectively defined, accurately measured, and easily observed? Does your target behavior pass the dead man's test? This is something important to think about and ask yourself when deciding which behaviors to actually target while working with a particular learner. Those in the field of behavior analysis use the dead man's test to determine whether or not the behavior being emitted can actually be considered a behavior at all. The dead man's test was first developed by Ogden Lindsley in 1965. He stated that if someone who is deceased can exhibit the behavior, then it is not a behavior and does not pass the dead man's test. Essentially, only living organisms have the ability to emit behavior, and in order to measure a behavior, it has to pass the dead man's test. The dead man's test came about as a response to many teachers who were using very loose measures regarding the behaviors they were targeting. For example, teachers were tracking duration of on-task behavior, when in reality, time on task was just students sitting at their desk and not necessarily attending or engaging to the task at hand. Another example would be minutes without a tantrum. What was the child doing when there was no tantrum? Because technically, a dead man can also not emit a tantrum. One example that a lot of us use in daily practice is non-compliance. Your definition probably says something like this: failure to comply with a demand within a certain amount of time. Can a dead man fail to comply with a demand? The answer is yes. This is just some food for thought to make you think about how you define your target behaviors, especially next time a teacher tells you that a student is being non-compliant and that they would like to target this behavior. A behavior that is similar that would pass the dead man's test might be active refusal. You could then define what refusal looks like, including things that only a living organism can do. An example of refusal might be responding with a vocal protest of no or similar variation when a demand is placed. One downside to the dead man's test is that behavior analysts have widely accepted it without first critically evaluating this idea. Even though this test was first brought to everyone's attention in the mid-60s, this is something that still does not have much empirical data to support it, according to Critchfield in 2016. However, the biggest hurdle for evaluating the dead man's test is that the reasoning behind it is somewhat circular. The dead man's test associates behavior with being alive, and anything a dead person can do is not considered behavior. So, alive equals behavior, and dead equals not behavior. This brings us to the next discussion, that all behavior must be observable and measurable. Yes, things that a dead person can do also can be measured, so behavior analysts need to be careful about which target behaviors they are choosing to observe and measure. Behavior analysts need to choose socially significant and active behaviors. So instead of saying a student who is not doing one's work, it could potentially be changed to talking during a non-contextual time instead of doing the expected task. Additionally, this behavior must be defined as such, objective, clear, and concise. In doing so, you are more likely to have success in your behavior, passing the dead man's test. Arguments have been made in favor of the dead man's test, given that there are many observable behaviors that a dead man cannot perform. For example, a child yells help when he needs to open the door. Another example would be throwing a ball across the yard. Based on our own personal experiences, we can probably correctly assume a dead person will not be doing any of these examples. These examples suggest that we could evaluate the dead man's test by taking frequency data on how often a living person emits these behaviors and how often a dead person might admit those behaviors, according to Critchfield and Shue in 2018. Chances are the living organism is going to emit those behaviors at a much higher rate than a deceased one, if at all. In most recent years, some preliminary studies have been conducted to evaluate the dead man's test. A study by Critchfield and Shue again in 2018 found that when observing three different organisms that were considered to be deceased, the behaviors being measured, sitting up and head turning, did not occur. Therefore, a dead organism cannot emit the same behavior as someone who is alive. The study demonstrates support for the dead man's test, but there still is not enough empirical evidence behind it. Potential future research should focus on the behaviors and the terminology that is still widely being used today. This may include aggression, non-compliance, property destruction, on-task behavior, attending, absence of challenging behaviors, or elopement. Each one of these target behaviors could be put to the test to determine which ones would actually pass the dead man's test. Thanks for watching.